I am resurrection and I am life, says the Lord. Whoever has faith in me shall have life, even though they die. And everyone who has life and has committed himself to me in faith shall not die forever. As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives, and that at the last he will stand upon the earth. After my awakening, he will raise me up, and in my body I shall see God. I myself shall see, and my eyes behold him, who is my friend and not my stranger. For none of us has life in himself, and none becomes his own master when he dies. For if we have life, we are alive in the Lord, and if we die, we die in the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's possession. Happy from now on are those who die in the Lord. So it is, says the Spirit, for they rest from their labors.
Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We gather today in the sure and certain hope of the resurrection to give thanks to God for the life of Jean Pitzer, loving wife to Gordon, grandmother to John and Jim and his wife Shannon, grandmother to Jessica and Molly, great-grandmother to Ava, Gwen, Andrew, Jonathan, and Amelia, faithful friend to many, and beloved child of God. Even as we mourn the loss of Jean this morning, we can also rejoice knowing that she is safe in the hands of the Lord. We can also rejoice in the legacy that Jean has left in our world and in our hearts and here at Westminster. Hear these words of Scripture. Jesus says that I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear God. As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you, says the Lord. And Paul writes in his letter to the Romans that I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let us pray. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, you formed us from the dust of the earth, and by your breath you gave us life. We glorify you. Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life, you tasted death for all humanity, and by rising from the grave you open the way to eternal life. We praise you. Holy Spirit, author and giver of life, you are the comforter of all who sorrow, our sure confidence and everlasting hope. We worship you. Be with us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as we remember your daughter, Jean. Amen.
Thank you.
I now invite Jim and John's cousin Marty up for our first reading.
An Old Testament reading from Isaiah 30. Therefore, the Lord waits to be gracious to you. Therefore, he will rise up to show mercy to you. For the Lord is God of justice. Blessed are all those who wait for him. Truly, O people of Zion, inhabitants of Jerusalem, you shall weep no more. He will surely be gracious to you at the sound of your cry. When he hears it, he will answer you. Though the Lord may give you the bread of adversity and the waters of affliction, yet your teacher will not hide himself anymore, but your eyes shall see your teacher. And when you turn to the right or when you turn to the left, your ears shall hear a word behind you saying, "This is the way, walk in it." The word of the Lord.
Our next scripture reading is Psalm 23, and I invite you to join with me in reading Psalm 23 as printed in your bulletin. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord. Our next reading comes from Romans 6. Are you unaware that we who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were indeed buried with him through baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live in newness of life. If then we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. We know that Christ raised from the dead dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for hymn number 836, Abide With Me.
Please stand for the gospel reading. Remain standing. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." And Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and I am the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she replied. "I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is to come into the world." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Our mother loved reading the Psalms just as her mother did. So please allow me to begin by reading a portion of Psalm 30. "I will exalt you, Lord, for you lifted me out of the depths and did not let my enemies gloat over me. Lord, my God, I called to you for help and you healed me. You, Lord, brought me up from the realm of the dead. You spared me from going down to the pit. Sing the praises of the Lord, you, his faithful people. Praise his holy name. For his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping comes at night, but joy comes in the morning." We are here to celebrate the life of Willa Jean Mack Pitzer. Trust me, the fact that I started this remembrance with her full name, Willa Jean, got her attention very quickly. Our mother was born in a small town, Blair, Oklahoma, and she was so proud of that, although it resulted in constant ribbing from her 2 sons. She had 2 siblings, Lucille and Bert, and they were all very different. However, they all had the Mack trait of being strong-willed, independent, and tough. Mom managed to mix in kindness and thoughtfulness, which would in many ways become the foundation which defined who she was as a person. Her father was a rural mail carrier, and she often rode with him to deliver mail to the surrounding farms around Blair. She learned to sew at an early age, a skill that would serve her for years to come. She made her first dress at the age of 8 without a pattern. Later in life, she made clothes not only for herself, for my father, for my brother Jim, and me, but soon it became a small business. And she made clothes for women in the neighborhood and her church community. And eventually, she even made the wedding dress for her niece and my cousin, our cousin, Gail. She created many liturgical banners and then used her sewing skills to put them together. To honor her, Westminster has hung all the banners that you see that Jean Pitzer's handprint was on. During the volunteer years, as we called them in our house, Mom helped to start the pony ministry at Medical Center of Arlington, cutting out and stuffing over 4,000 ponies, they were given to young children in the hospital who were sick. Later in life, she became the primary caregiver for our dad. And after that, she wrote a book. The title, My Journey as an Alzheimer's Caregiver, You Too Can Survive. Jim and I were certainly blessed to have a mother that was loving, kind, funny, sweet, welcoming, smart, practical, talented, and a rock of faith. Weeping may come at night, but joy comes in the morning. One of the many talents that our mother possessed was that of painting. She painted china and ceramics. A couple of those are in the foyer, you may have seen. And when she turned 60, she finally decided she wanted to paint on canvas. So she took lessons, even though I don't think she needed them. Three of her paintings are also in the foyer for you to see. The first time I saw her very first painting, I said, Mom, I don't want to insult you, or I don't want you to think I'm rude, but did you paint by numbers? She gasped at that question. I asked the question because I didn't know she painted, and it was really, really good. Maybe you didn't know she painted either. She didn't make a big deal of it. However, I am reminding you of her painting skills because I'm going to use that medium to describe who Jean Pitzer really was. To do that, I'm going to now paint for you three paintings. They have never actually been put on canvas. But with a little work and a little imagination, I think that you can picture them in your mind. These three paintings, to steal a phrase from my Dominican tradition, are like three pillars that make up the foundation of who Jean Pitzer was and what she stood upon. These paintings will give you a window into a beautiful soul, the soul of Willa Jean Mack Pitzer. Weeping may come at night, but joy comes in the morning. In the first painting, there is a young family sitting on the floor around a coffee table playing Monopoly. The year is 1964. The town is Wichita Falls, Texas. In this painting, you would find our dad, Gordon, our mother, Jean, and two small boys named Jimmy and Johnny. Sitting alongside us in this painting are three men who are not members of our family. In fact, they look very different than we do. They are military servicemen from the countries of Ethiopia and Iran. The Ethiopian man named Demos had beautiful, coal black skin. The two servicemen from Iran had a golden, dark brown glow. The reality is, our parents had decided to sign up for a program at Shepherd Air Force Base in Wichita Falls, and it was called Entertaining Foreign Students. Rather original, don't you think? It was a way to show these men what American culture was like and to give them a place to call home when they weren't at home. When the Wichita Falls paper wanted to do a story on the program, our family was chosen. So this scene that I have painted for you was an actual photograph that ended up on the front page of the Wichita Falls paper. Friends of our parents were a bit concerned what it might look like. Remember, it's 1964, small town in Texas. Racial unrest is everywhere. Need I say more? According to what our parents told us later, there was no consideration of not allowing the Wichita Falls paper to do the story, knowing full well that the picture would be on the front page of the paper, with all of us sitting around the coffee table with three men who did not look like us. For several years in the mid to late 60s, we had black and brown foreign students in our home on a regular basis. They would push Jim and I in the cart or the buggy, I'm dating myself, at the grocery store while Mom went looking for an item in the store. Oh, what that must have looked like. Jim and I spoke later in life, and we told our mother on numerous occasions that she, along with our father, were planting the seeds of inclusivity and acceptance in the hearts of their two little boys. Jean Mack Pitzer did not care what you looked like. She did not care where you were from or where you went to church. She didn't even care who you voted for, and I am proof of that. This beautiful piece of art that is now painted for you is a painting of inclusivity and acceptance. Weeping comes at night, but joy comes in the morning. The second painting, there is a woman sitting alone at a breakfast table early in the morning. She is sitting with her hands clasped together in prayer and her head leaning against her hands. The house is quiet, and our mother is in prayer. Daily morning devotionals began in the Pitzer house when I was entering junior high and my brother was in high school. We had attended a Billy Graham crusade in Texas Stadium where the Cowboys used to play. After attending, we received daily devotions in the mail. We were already praying a lot. We prayed at every meal, taking turns going around the table, saying our prayers before we crawled into bed. So our mother took the suggestion of the spiritual advisors from the crusade, and the new tradition of morning devotionals soon began. This included every morning scripture reading, a reflection on the reading, and then a spontaneous prayer. I don't think Jim and I were too enthusiastic about that at the time. And to be honest with you, I'm not sure how enthusiastic our father was either. But the tradition began and lasted for over 40 years. Every day, a morning devotional around the breakfast table. Our mother knew exactly what she was doing. She was once again planting seeds in her young boys. Seeds of spirituality and faith. When Jim and I left for college, our mother and father continued these daily devotions. This is when, and once my dad died in 2001, they continued more. This is when this particular painting took place. I was home visiting from Louisiana, and I walked into the kitchen to the breakfast area, and I stopped dead in my tracks so I wouldn't disturb her, because I stumbled upon my mother in prayer. I stood there for several minutes and simply watched. Faith and spirituality in action. Our mother was a carbon copy of her mother, our grandmother, Ruth Mack. This beautiful piece of art that is now painted for you is a painting of faith and spirituality. Weeping may come at night, but joy comes in the morning. In the third and final painting, the scene is set on the San Antonio Riverwalk. A beautiful scene any time of the year. But in this painting, it was decorated for Christmas. Lights hanging from the trees, and yes, even a bit of chill in the air. The sidewalks of the San Antonio River were packed with people out to enjoy the holiday evening on a Saturday night. Among all the people in this painting, two individuals stand out. An older woman walking hand in hand with a young man. Everyone else in the painting blends in with the surroundings. Here is the real context. Our mother, Jean, is walking hand in hand with a friend of mine from Austin. He, along with his partner and my friend Debbie from Louisiana, had traveled with me and Mom to San Antonio for this holiday evening. Because of the crowds, because of the conversation that captured my attention, I lost track of where Mom was. I turned around to see her walking hand in hand with my friend. I knew immediately what the conversation was, and later, he confirmed it. My friend had recently come out to his parents, and things had not gone very well. He was not speaking to his parents at the time and needed an adopted mom for the moment. someone to listen, someone not to judge, to simply love. I had already shared with Mom what was going on in my friend's life, and it was she who initiated the conversation. My friend eventually reconciled with his parents and to this day has a wonderful relationship with his mother. This beautiful piece of art that is now painted for you is a painting of unconditional love. Weeping may come at night, but joy comes in the morning. If I had to choose for you one of those paintings or one of those pillars that would have been the most important to her, it would be the pillar of faith, without question. Because Jean Pitzer believed that from her faith, from being a follower of Jesus Christ, everything else flowed from that. Being hospitable, being kind, showing unconditional love. It all came from her faith. In the gospel that we just listened to, which she chose, by the way, along with every hymn that you have sung today, we have Martha and Mary who are distressed because their brother Lazarus is dead. Jesus finally makes his way to Bethany. And once he's there, I love this gospel so much because I think we're all a little bit of Martha and a little bit of Mary all the time. Martha runs out and says to Jesus in a very almost threatening way, if you would have been here, my brother would not have died. That's when Jesus says, he will rise on the last day. Martha says, I know that. And then Jesus says, I am the resurrection and I am the life. If you believe in me, you will never die. And then he says to Martha, do you believe this? And Martha says, yes, Lord, I believe. My friends, Jean Mac Pitzer believed with every fiber of her being. And she did everything she could to make sure that her family believed and her friends believed. There is an old hymn that was written in the late 1800s. It was made popular in 1984 in the movie A Trip to Bountiful with Geraldine Page. Softly and tenderly. Now, you may have heard it before. You may have heard it the first time during that movie. The first time I heard it when my mother played it on the piano. She didn't play often, but when she played, it was usually out of the hymn book. And the first time I ever heard Softly and Tenderly was in our living room in Wichita Falls, Texas. And it's a hymn of going home. So if you'll listen for a moment. Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling, calling, O sinner, come home. Welcome home, Jean. Welcome home. Thank you. Your response will be, "Hear us, Lord." For Jean, our mother, sister, aunt, and friend, let us pray to our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, "I am resurrection and I am life." Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Jean, and dry the tears of those who weep. Hear us, Lord. You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow. Hear us, Lord. You raised the dead to life. Give Jean eternal life. Hear us, Lord. You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring Jean to the joys of heaven. Hear us, Lord. Jean was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give her fellowship with all your saints. Hear us, Lord. Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of Jean. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope. Together we pray the prayer that Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Thank you. I think John did this to me 18 years ago when our dad passed away. He spoke before I did. It's like when the varsity team gets off the court and the coach says, "Hey, all you freshmen, come on in. You got the court now, you know." So I'm not going to sing. But I will say that Billy Graham concert that we went to the program was when I became a believer of Christ for the first time. So I think I know two people that actually had become saved at a Billy Graham concert, even though you know there are millions around the world that had that. And that movie, Trip to Bountiful, is Shannon's favorite movie, actually, by the way. I'm not sure you knew that. Good. So I want to start off by saying thank you for those who have come. I know there are some who have come from a long way, like Austin and Hammond, Louisiana. I heard some in Memphis, yes, and some even came from Chicago, I think. Oh, wait, that's me. Sorry. It was in my head. I knew there was somebody from... But I want to say that I love the state of Oklahoma. I'm going to kind of go back a little bit from what I said on my Facebook message when I announced that she had passed away a few weeks ago. That's been an inside joke since 1968 or 69. I just had to say something about that. So I do love a lot of great cousins and cousins-in-laws from Oklahoma, so I just want to get that out of the way. I do love cooking. Also, I want to get out of the way. I'm not going to talk about her cooking. Everybody's mother was a great cook. So I'm just going to leave it at that, and then you know that she was a great cook. Had a lot of great recipes. Yeah, just good memories. I think my wall in high school was lined with these things, and she was practicing her designs, you know. I'm going to tell you some stories that you don't probably know about her. The first time I realized that grades were important to her, I was probably in fifth grade. I played football. And my grades had slipped one year, and my dad was one of the assistant coaches on our team, and my mom announced at dinner one night that I would not be playing until my grades came up. I thought my dad was going to choke on his dinner when he heard that. I'm not sure who was more upset, my dad or me, but it took about 3 weeks for my grades to get back up, and I was able to play again. But she also wanted us to succeed, and no matter what we did, sports, music, whatever. I can remember, I may have mentioned this story when my dad passed away. My parents both did this at one time or another. In Wichita Falls, you played football, and you had weight limits on your leagues. So 75 pounds and under, 90 pounds and under, and then 120 pounds and under, I think, were the weight limits. And I was right on the 90-pound limit. And they would do weigh-ins at the start of every year. And they would have you go in your uniform so you could show your colors. And then you would go to the boys' club in downtown Wichita Falls, and you would have weigh-ins. And we were right on the limit, me and a couple of buddies. So this year, my mom decided to get us all up early, get our uniforms on, about 2 hours before the weigh-in, and she had the windows up in the car, the heater on full blast, for 2 hours driving around Wichita Falls, Texas, trying to get us to lose that extra pound or two. And I think everybody in the car lost an extra pound or two. We were all just drenched in sweat, including Jean, but she wanted us to succeed, and so that was another memory that I had. That's one of the first things that popped into my head. You know, I knew I'd be up here and speaking about her, and I want to just kind of tell you some stories that probably you didn't know, you know, by working with her at the hospital or being a cousin or whatever, a friend from church. But I also wanted to talk about the first time I really, I guess as an adult, felt her grace towards me. I was a freshman in college, and probably shouldn't be telling a story, but I will. Freshman in college, and Arlington High School was still really good in basketball, and they were in the playoffs by district game somewhere at Birdville Stadium in Fort Worth, I believe. And I'm out with a couple of friends before the game. We'd had a couple of drinks before the game, and we get to the game, show up to the game, and my mom's probably the first person I see in the building. And we're talking, and I'm trying to stay as far away from her as I can. And she looks at me, and she says, "Have you been drinking?" I said, "No, somebody gave me some grape gum, and I just didn't like it, so I threw it out." And she looks at me like, kind of just looked like, she's, you know, for about, seemed like 10 seconds. She goes, "Well, you know what, then if you don't like it, just I'd stay away from that gum the rest of the night." You know, I said, "Okay." So the rest of the night, I'm looking behind our car thing, and she's following me, you know, wherever we're after the game. But a thought came to mind that John reminded me of recently that night, because I know when she was growing up, her siblings were Bert and Lucille, and their dad used to tell them, "You know, you can go to hell for lying like you can for cheating." And I kept waiting for her to say that to me, but she didn't say it that night. But I knew I'd lied to her, and so sorry, Mom. I'm not sure I never brought that story up to her, but she did say, "Stay away from that grape gum." So we moved to Arlington, and I'm not going to be very long. I just got a couple more stories. We moved to Arlington in 1970. I started playing basketball my sophomore year, and Mom worked at the high school. She was a secretary there. And she bled green and gold and maroon and white, I think, for Oklahoma. There's another color besides white. It's not just white, but it's crimson and cream. Thank you, Elaine. Yeah, I knew one of y'all would know. But so we would, you know, there were a lot of restaurants right across the street from the high school here on Cooper. And at one point, I'm trying to figure out, am I that popular, or is there a reason the number of friends keep adding to the people that go to lunch with me? Because anytime we were late from lunch, we would go by her office and get a pass to get back into class, and we would get back into class. And at one point, I turned around one day, and there was like seven of us around her desk, you know, because there's nobody from the high school, I think, that was here today, right, worked for her back in those days? Okay, good. I know Mr. Lackey passed away years ago. I wouldn't want him to know that story. But she was just, you know, she knew we were trying to get back on time, and she just wanted to be nice to my friends, and so she would write passes every single time we were late. We're trying to take advantage of it too much, you know, maybe twice a week, three times a week, so. Some weeks we were good like that. But she loved the Lord. She loved the Lord. She loved my dad. And then it was kind of a toss-up between me and John in the state of Oklahoma. But we knew she loved us, and we loved her so much. And so the last thing I want to say is, you know, I think I mentioned in one of my messages on Facebook, she was always thanking people for what they did for her. You know, she was in the hospital probably a month before she passed away up in Elmhurst, Illinois. Forgot I was down here in Texas. Well, I almost forgot I was down here in Texas. This heat's a little. But she was always thanking the nurses. And she was, didn't know where she was. She was in pain, but always thank you. It took her to the bathroom one day. Thank you, thank you. So, Mom, thank you for all you did for us, and we really appreciate how you brought us up, and it meant a lot to us to have you as a mom. So, thank you.
We'll continue with the commendation which is found in your service sheet. You only are immortal, the creator of maker of human mankind, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but everlasting life. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting life, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. I invite you to stand as you are able for our closing hymn, number 687. Before I offer you the final blessing, I want you to know that when the family processes out, they are going directly to Fellowship Hall behind the church, where most of you know where that is. So if you would like to greet anyone from the family, we invite you to go there. It's just going to make it a lot easier so it won't get bottlenecked in the hallway. My dear friends, life is indeed short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those that walk with us. So please be quick to love and make haste to be kind. And may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you forever. Amen.